enlightenment has to be for all of existence, or it's for none of it, really. You cannot be enlightened alone. The enlightenment has to be for everyone, or it's for no one, because reality is one. You cannot say, well, I'm enlightened and everybody else is not, and I can go into paradise and nobody else can. It has to be for all, not just people, all of existence, the totality of it. You have to extend, enlightenment has to be extended to all of it. And fortunately for us, it already has been extended to all of it. You see, existence has already been enlightened. We keep thinking about that enlightenment as something to do with us as a person. It does not. It does not. Existence has already been enlightened, as it were. These are ways of talking. It's already been saved. Unconditional love overlays it entirely from the very beginning, immediately. It's already been saved. So all we need to do is to accept that fact. Okay? Now, the acceptance of that fact can seem to be an individual choice. A choice of this aspect of spirit accepts the fact. But so we don't do the enlightening. The enlightening's already happened. Unconditional love has overlaid existence from the very beginning, equally distributed to all, with no change whatsoever. Because it's a different idea. It's the idea of not trying to change reality. Okay? And that idea of not trying to change reality accompanied the idea of trying to change reality. So, from the very beginning, this entire dream of trying to change reality has been saved. We've been, you know, it's already been there always. So, our role is simply to accept it. Accept this fact as something that's already been accomplished. That's it. And so each aspect of spirit, they differ as to when they accept it for themselves. Because what we're doing now is we're saying, no, it hasn't been saved yet, meaning there's still a chance we can change reality, and we're rejecting it. We have the right to do that. We're entitled to continue to pursue this fantasy of changing reality and being prime creator. We have the right to do that. But the remedy has already been present. It's always been present. And we can accept that fact too at any time, any moment we want to, we can accept it. So it is not our enlightenment, so to speak. We can say that, but what's really taking place is we are finally acknowledging the enlightenment that's always been there, the salvation that's always been there. We're just saying, okay. So this is the right way of looking about the whole situation, really. All this idea of like we have to struggle for our enlightenment. Enlightenment is given by God, by reality, by the idea of not trying to change reality, that overlays, that provides an alternative, unconditional love that is lossless. There's no change, no loss, no desire, no activity of that kind whatsoever. And it overlays the totality of existence. The entire dream is overlaid with this presence that's equally distributed everywhere. It's always been there. And all we need to do is acknowledge it. Isn't that great? So all of existence is already saved. We don't have to do it. This should take an enormous burden off our backs. We're thinking that somehow we have to figure out how to save existence. We got to be its saviors. No, it's already been saved. All our part is simply to accept this fact. That's it. and then explain to others that this is all they need to do. It's so simple. It is so simple. Everyone's taking their morning walk, Sunday morning, August 5th. And it's, we're taking our morning walk, our jog, as it were. And the morning jog this morning is a great one. It's really great. I mean, I didn't know what I was going to say when I clicked record. And it just so happens that this clarification just arose. You know, this morning I'd been doing a lot of contemplation and prayer and clarification. And sort of saying, you know, enlightenment has to be for everything. It cannot just be for one person or one aspect. No, it has to be for everyone. And then I realized, oh, it just came out that it's already present. It's already accomplished. It was accomplished from the very beginning. Only the time we take to recognize that is something that we have to deal with. We're dealing with that. So there is no question about enlightenment. It's already happened for everyone, for everything. It exists. The entire dream has been enlightened, as it were, overlaid, saved. The remedy has always been there. And it, again, it's just a recognition. So when we recognize an unconditional love, the perfect peace, the seamless peace, we simply recognize it, that it overlays everything in existence. And there's never been anything that it does not overlay. No matter what time, place, and circumstance rises in this dream, it's already overlaid equal distribution. Total equal distribution of lossless, changeless presence, unconditional love. It's already there. We don't have to do anything to keep it there. We don't have to do anything to establish it, maintain it. We don't need to do anything. It's always been there, always will be there. All we have to do is rest in this realization, acceptance, rest in seeing it. And I've said that we need this vision to see it. We're working towards that. And we recognize our part is simply to see it. That's all. That's only our part, is only to see it, that it's there. We didn't give rise to it, as it were. Well, technically, since we're spirit, we chose the idea of not trying to change reality. So we did give rise to it, as it were. But it's our spirit that gave rise to it. Not any energy gave rise to it. Not any soul, or mind, emotion, desire, consciousness, awareness, all this stuff, that didn't give rise to it. No. Reality gave rise to it. Reality. So this is extremely good news that I'm able to share here. Everything has already been enlightened. Always has been. Always will be. And it's only our denial of this that is the problem. Our denial of it is so that we can pretend that we have the power to change reality. That's it. Nothing more than that. If we want to continue to pretend that dreams have some power over reality, then we won't see it. We won't see it. And the way that reality works is that if we want to, we entertain this idea that we have the power to change reality, we won't be aware that we don't. So we won't be able to see this overlay, that it's already been saved, everything has been enlightened already. We won't be able to see it, because that would end our pretense, and we have the right to pretend, you see? So everyone that doesn't see this, they simply are exercising their right to pretend. That's all. Nothing more than that. Existence is a vast pretense. It's a vast pretending. It's just spirit pretending that it has the power and the authority and the capability to change reality. That's all it is. That's 100% all it is. It's simply a pretending. And We have the right to do that. We're entitled to. We're free. We're free. We're free. We're free to pretend if we want to. We're also free to give up our pretense if we want to, which is very key. All right, very key. But whether we pretend or not, existence was overlaid from the very beginning with unconditional love, with this other idea, the counterpart, the idea of not trying to change reality. That idea immediately arose as a counterpart, as a remedy. It's always been there. So we can avail ourselves of that at any moment. Any moment we want to, we can avail ourselves of that. Always. It's always there. Always will be there. For everyone, equally. Equal access. It's equally distributed already. We don't have to worry about, you know, how to distribute it. It's always there. As far as telling other people about it, the Holy Spirit does that. I mean, it itself, the overlay, unconditional love itself, tells everyone that it's there. So there's no worry about just, you know, how to tell people about it. It's always within. It's always there. And witnesses to this can be helpful too, in small ways. But again, no amount of witnessing is effective to those who want to continue to pretend that they have a power that they don't really have. No amount of witnessing does anything. They simply, because they have equal right, equal power. Everyone has equal freedom. Therefore, if they want to exercise their freedom to pretend they have a power that they don't really have, nobody can, there's no power that can force them to stop that. None. No such power. Everyone has equal freedom. Freedom is the law of reality. So everyone is free to either pretend or not pretend. The trouble we have in existence is that those who are pretending that they have a greater power than reality, power over reality, they believe they have the power to prevent anyone to stop pretending that they have this power. In other words, they feel that their power is vulnerable to, if others stop this pretense, they feel that somehow their power has been made vulnerable. So it's difficult in this dream, this pretense, for anyone to accept that it's everything has already been enlightened, the whole thing has already been enlightened, already been saved. It's difficult because there's pressure not to do that. Because the pretense feels vulnerable to this. It feels that somehow this is not right, that it's somehow limiting its freedom. Remember, we have the freedom to pretend. But that doesn't make the pretending real. We don't have the freedom to limit our freedom. We don't have the freedom to change our freedom. So everybody's free to either pretend or not pretend. But again, pretending, freedom doesn't make pretending real. And therein lies the problem that we struggle with. Trying to limit everyone else's freedom so that this pretense, there's nothing, no external reference point that would indicate that this pretending is pretending. But again, we are free, and which includes our freedom to pretend that we have a power that we don't have. But doesn't make it real. Will never make it real. But therein lies the problem that we struggle with. If everything has already been saved from the very beginning, everything is already enlightened, how come we don't accept it? See, that's the big question. And it is what we all struggle with and scratch our heads. Say, why? You know, and we tend to doubt the fact that everything's already been saved because nobody's accepting this fact. Very few. And we think, well, if this is true, how come everyone doesn't accept it? And we struggle with this. And I'm trying to clarify this. It's very important. It's because there is this abiding demand in pretense that everyone has to continue the pretense. Otherwise, it will somehow limit the freedom of the pretense. And this is simply not true, because the pretense is that we should be able to pretend forever, and that by pretending forever, it will make it real. So that if anyone breaks ranks, it is seen as a denial of this freedom to pretend forever. It's not. It's not. The false premise is that in pretending forever, that somehow it makes it real. That means we really do have a power greater than reality. We have the power to change reality. It's not true. That is simply a mistake. But there is this incredible pressure for nobody to break ranks. And this plays out, of course we all do want to break ranks. But what we do is we offer all these substitute enlightenments, all these other paths that don't really provide what we really want. They provide what we think we want, but not what we really want, as a substitute, so that we still continue on with the pretense, instead of simply seeing that everything is already saved, which is a piece of cake. And instead we work at enlightenment. We work at all this consciousness, manipulation of consciousness, and all this stuff that still maintains a pretense. In other words, we don't really break ranks. So that is why it's so few have simply accepted the means that is given to us, that is already there, has always been there. That is completely simple and easy, because people will hate them and say, you are the one who's preventing us from being greater than God, and you have to come back into the fold eventually, or they say you have to be annihilated somehow, because you're somehow preventing their freedom. You're somehow, of course, the whole idea that of pretense of having a power greater than God, that itself is an attempt to destroy freedom. Because the power of God is freedom. That is freedom. And to change it would mean to be something other than that, other than perfect freedom. If you have perfect freedom and you change it, how can it be anything other than not perfect freedom? Right? Has to be that. Has to be that. If we have perfect safety and we want to change that, it has to be something other than perfect safety. We can say, well, it's greater than perfect safety. But it still has to be other than perfect safety. We can say it's greater than perfect freedom. It still has to be something other than perfect freedom. Okay? It's very important to hear that. Because there is this demand in existence that we don't break ranks. We don't allow ourselves to see that all existence has been saved. We don't allow ourselves our freedom under the guise that we're somehow working on something greater than perfect freedom, which is a mistake. We're not working. We're working on trying to deny freedom for ourselves by saying that we cannot choose a different idea than trying to change reality. That's a denial of our freedom. And we say, well, it's a temporary denial because we're working on trying to give more than perfect freedom, which is, of course, ridiculous. And so existence is really insane. It's really completely insane. It doesn't see that. It will say, yes, it's temporarily completely insane, but that eventually, when it remains completely insane forever, it will become the new sanity, as it were. It's kind of like, it says, yes, existence is completely insane. However, once it's greater than reality, then this insanity will become the new sanity. See? And of course, but what better definition of insanity is there than that, to say that? It's like the insane saying, well, if we just remain insane forever, it will become sanity. That's a vain hope. It's a vain hope. existence rests on a foundation of vain hopes. Hopelessness really rests. And again, it simply says, well, if we simply rest in this hopelessness forever, it will become real. If we just believe that we have the power to change reality, and we just believe it forever, it will then become true. But of course, the question is, how long is forever? You see, that is the question that's not being addressed. And forever, there is no time, there is no point you can point to at all. It's not possible. So it's insanity. This stance is insane. The opposite of sanity is the belief that there's some end to forever. That forever can be somehow outlasted, because reality is forever. It's endless. So how can we outlast forever or endlessness? We cannot. We cannot do it. It cannot be accomplished. But this is the foundation, the premise that pretense rests upon. Otherwise, we would see, we would choose unconditional love right now. So we're trapped in insanity, really. Insanity means the inverse of sanity. We're trapped in this inverse of sanity. Hopelessness. We're in a hopeless situation. Our goal is hopeless. And in our adventurousness, in our resoluteness, in our creativity, etc., we have pursued this goal and all through all sorts of clever means, trying to find out if we can accomplish it. And it just our creativity has just gotten all wound up in this. Extremely wound up in it. And this unwinding is what clarification does. It unwinds it all. But there is no doubt that we have gotten incredibly wound up in plausibility. I call it the logic of plausibility. It's important to realize this and acknowledge it, that there's no limit to the play of plausibility. We can continue to play with it if we want to. It's like magical, like in dreams. We can dream up anything we want to, right? We can dream up a mountain range, and then we can dream that mountain range melts into the sea. We can dream anything we want to dream. And in plausibility, we can make anything seem plausible. Yeah, we can. And so we have used our creativity for imagining and dreaming and pursuing plausibility, and it's all wound up in this vast, endless swamp of plausibility, where it seems like we can always make a plausible case that we can't accomplish whatever we want to. We can't accomplish the impossible. There's nothing impossible for us. There's nothing impossible for plausibility, as it were. In other words, it can always seem plausible, but seeming plausible doesn't make it real. It merely is a seeming of plausibility in our imagination. Plausibility works with imagination. We can imagine an end to endlessness. We can imagine that somehow we can accomplish the impossible. And we can make it seem very plausible. But it only seems. It's only a seeming. It's not a reality. Never will be. So, being wound up in this, our creativity and our adventurousness is wound up in this dream of plausibility. So much so that every step towards simply accepting that salvation, that everything's already been saved, already enlightened, it seems booby-trapped. The whole thing seems booby-trapped. We're able to make it seem that it's dangerous. that it's the path is absolutely strewn with, you know, booby traps everywhere, and that every step we take, we are on the brink of annihilation. That's how we've used our creativity. We've used our creativity to make it seem like the remedy is totally dangerous to us and will annihilate us. It's all plausibility, and we've done it. The fact that we're still here today is testimony to the fact that we have done this. We've in our imagination, we've booby-trapped it all and made it seem impossibly dangerous, which is why it is so difficult to accept, simply see that everything's already enlightened. But I can tell you for sure that there is a way to get past all of this, which is the voice of reason. Not the voice of plausibility, the voice of reason. The voice of reason is the counterpart to plausibility, the logical plausibility. So the path is difficult because we have set up all this plausibility that we can be, that it doesn't work, it's not there, it's going to annihilate us. All these fears, simply so that we stay away from it, we reject it, we reject reality. That's how we've done it. We've used our creativity to frighten ourselves. And you might be saying, uh-oh, that's not good. Yeah. None of it's true. No matter what we dream, the overlay is already there. Everything's already enlightened. It always has been, always will be. That's a fact. It's always there, untouched by our dreams. So we simply are delaying. Everything we do is simply a delaying tactic. But boy, are we talented at delaying tactics. Very talented. Because it's our creativity. We use our freedom. We're using our freedom to try and deny our freedom. Okay? And we frighten ourselves, and we're very good at frightening ourselves. We intimidate ourselves. We scare ourselves. We conjure up vast, endless swamps in our trek to try and simply realize everything's already enlightened. We set up these endless barriers and swamps, and we keep saying, no, we have to work on our own personal enlightenment. That's a misdirection. It's a totally misdirection. It's an attempt to limit it, right? It's an attempt to, that just bogs us down endlessly, because then we think, well, if I'm enlightened, but no one else is, we have to enlighten them also. And then that bogs us down even worse and worse and worse and worse. We don't have to enlighten anyone. Everyone's already enlightened. We simply need to accept this fact. And there's nothing we need to do. It's already been done. We can share this fact, but it's already, whether we share it or not, it's already been done. So it's not consequential. The sharing is not that consequential. And those who see this know that. It can be helpful in certain situations. It can also be ill-advised in certain other situations where there are those who would take it the wrong way. So, but in any case, no matter what the case is in existence, everything is fine. Everything is already perfect. Everything is already saved. Will always be that way. So there's no reason to be sad or feel stressed out or think that you have to save the world. No, you don't have to save the world. It's already been saved. You don't have to do anything. It's already been done. Everything that needs to be done has already been done. Everything. Now, you can help lessen delay if there are opportunities for that. Maybe there's no opportunities for it. Who knows? But inevitably, there will be some. Inevitably. The nature of existence, the nature of the situation is there are those who are tired of this pretense and the logical plausibility and the suffering and the misery and the fear, and they can't stand it, and they really want to know. So inevitably, there will be some that will benefit. But you don't have to be here. Nobody has to spread the word. The word is already there. The truth is already there. Freedom is already there. Enlightenment of everything is already there. It's always been there. Nobody needs to do anything. Nobody needs to do anything. That is true. None of us need to do anything. There's not a single aspect of existence that needs to do anything. Never. No, it's always been the case. Always will be the case. Nobody has to do anything. And no matter what is done in existence, that remains true. Nobody has to do anything. Except, well, not even accept the fact that everything's been saved, that we don't even have to do that. Eventually, everyone will, but we don't have to. Nobody has to do anything. But if we leave aside that we let's say we need to accept the fact we don't need to do anything, it's already been saved. I guess that nobody needs to do anything that includes the fact that, well, we do, that is truth, that is fact, so we do have to accept truth. We can't avoid it. But as far as doing anything in existence, no, nothing has to be done. It's already been saved. It's already, whatever has to be accomplished was accomplished from the very beginning. So there's never been a point in existence where we had to do anything, or anyone had to do anything, or anything had to happen at all. Nothing had to happen. Nothing has to happen now. We don't need any happening at all. I don't even have to make this video. You don't even have to listen to it. But there again, I'm free to make the video. You're free to listen to it. The only purpose would be to lessen delay. That would be the purpose of it. Lessen the delay to the realization that no one has to do anything. Everything has already been accomplished. Meaning the overlay is already present. That was accomplished instantly. All in one instant. Equal overlay. Equal distribution was instant. Instantaneous. And that equal overlay, the equal presence has always been there. Unchanging, no loss, no gain, no loss, as it were. Equal quality, equal quantity, equal presence. That's always been the case. So all we need to do is see that fact. If we want to. If we don't want to, then we don't have to do that either. Of course, the only difference is for, I say, well, if we can either do it or not. It's the same. It's still there. And yet those who don't want to do it insist that nobody do it. And they say, well, if nobody does it, it means it's not there. Okay? This is the logical plausibility. If you want to know what is the logical plausibility, is to say, for example, if nobody accepts that this enlightenment is there, this equal overlay is there, if no one sees it, then the logical plausibility says, well, it's plausible then that it's not there. Okay? That is called the logical plausibility, and that is, it's crucial for us all to see through this, because it's ascribing a meaning which isn't true, because we're free to deny that it's there forever if we want to. But our freedom remains to also accept it, that it's there. We're free to deny or to accept. And to say that if nobody accepts it, that means that it's not there is insanity. It's the logical plausibility, but it seems very plausible, doesn't it? Because we say, well, if it was there, certainly someone would have accepted it. So it's extremely likely that it's not there. That's a logical possibility. But this is a moot point because many have accepted it already. And what we do is we say, well, their acceptance was temporary, or they were annihilated, or wasn't total, or we just forget it and say, no, just let's forget about them, or eventually, you know, we just deny it, use forms of denial about it. Just we either say, no, it never happened, never happened. And we just say, well, we just dreamed it happened, didn't really happen. We thought that it happened for a while, like these great, you know, saviors of humanity who are just simply say, yeah, everything's already been saved, just see it. That's all that they're here to tell us. And we just can ignore them, deny that they ever came here, or if we for a while believe they came here, we say, that was just a dream. It just happened in a dream, and so it's not real. So we can simply deny it that way. Plausible denial. And it is plausible denial, because if we don't realize that we're the ones that are dreaming, we can claim that anything happens here that we don't want to accept, we put that into the category of a dream, you see. So denial is very clever and tricky and uses a logical plausibility, and we have to reject it. It's a struggle for us, obviously, because the fact that everything has already been saved, everything's already been enlightened. That's always been the case, and yet we have been, you know, struggling in these swamps for so long. That just shows how clever our denials are, etc. In getting free of this, we think that we need to somehow attack our creativity and make it less. We can't do that. We cannot do it. It's impossible. That itself would be changing reality. So all this cleverness, you have to see through it. You don't try to attack the source of it and weaken it. That's not possible. That just makes things worse. What you have to do is acknowledge it and say, yeah, I've wanted this cleverness and it's there. It's very clever, it's there. But the voice of reason sees right through it, easily, and just dismisses it and shows you the difference between reason, truth, and plausibility. Just shows you the difference. It doesn't attack it. It doesn't try to diminish it and make it less, or attack the source of it. Try to, you know, wipe out the source. No, it just says, okay, this is what you've done. This is what you're doing. And it's very clever. And yet, it's not true. And you can hear, here's why it's not true. And just show you that. And then you see that and say, okay. So there's no attack at all on it. You say, okay, this is what I have wanted, but it's not ever been what I really want. Because what I really want is to choose a different idea. I don't want to choose this idea of loss. It's terrible. And then the voice of reason just says, okay, the reason why you're not accepting seeing that everything's already been saved, everything's already enlightened, is because you used your creativity in a way to frighten yourself. And all you need to do is just see that, just see how you did that. And then you see it and you say, oh, okay, I see. No wonder why I've been trapped. I use my creativity to for the purpose of denial and to scare myself and use all this type of plausible denial. And so, of course, I've been frightened. But you don't attack it. It's not an attack. Reason, the voice of reason is not an attack. It just sets the voice of reason and the logic of plausibility. It sets them side by side and just says, take a look at these two and compare them. That's all it does. Just compare. And said, which one do you feel at the deepest level of wisdom and truth? Which one do you believe is true? And the voice of reason insists, all it insists is that both can't be true. That's all. That's the only thing it ever insists upon. It says both cannot be true. So simply discern which is true and which is false. That's it. Doesn't attack, but it does insist both cannot be true. It says that lies and truth cannot both be true. So put the two opposing viewpoints that are mutually exclusive together and both put them on the table and look at both of them and then discern which is the lie and which is the truth. That's all you need to do. That's how the path works. A discernment, which is a lie and which is true. And then when you realize that, you don't need to do anything to the lie. You just let it be as it is. Don't need to attack it. You just say, ah, okay, now I see this is not true. It's a lie, and lies can't be true. I see that because they're mutually exclusive. What lies say is that both truth and lies can both be true. That's its basic premise. That is the basic premise of denial. That the entire logical plausibility rests on that basic false premise, that truth and lies can both be true, or that they can somehow be integrated together to form a new something better than both of them. Okay, which is not true. That's a lie. But so the voice of reason points this out over and over and over. It's the cornerstone. If you, as long as you believe that both truth and lies can be true, you are lost in this. The logic of plausibility has you ensnared, and you will, and of course it will send you on all sorts of so-called spiritual paths to make you think you're not ensnared. Okay, of course, once you're ensnared, what does a logical plausibility do? It tries to make you believe you're not ensnared by sending you off on some spiritual adventure, that is telling you you're going to be enlightened if you just take this path now, and you'll be really enlightened. And so you don't, you're so busy on this path of enlightenment, you don't realize that you've been ensnared, because you think to spend time doing that would be to somehow to take away time from your path of enlightenment. But there again, there is no path of enlightenment, as it were. There is a path to accepting that everything's already been enlightened, you don't need to do anything. There is that path, but that path has to do with, is rests on the premise that truth and lies can't both be true. It rests on that premise. And so you have to have that premise there. You're aware of it. You have to be aware of that. And you are aware of it. And if you're not aware of that, you're not on that path. The path to realization that you don't need to do anything. Because if you believe that both truth and lies can be true, then what you're really on is on the temporarily is the path of integrating those two, which is the only way you can deny it. You have to believe you can integrate the two, because within you know there's something wrong. And so first the path is to integrate the two, and then at some point you believe that something new, completely new than both the truth and lies, arise. But before we get there, there's a process of integration. So you'll be on the, what happens is you get on this path of integration, and you simply define it as the path of enlightenment, and you don't realize that you're simply on the path of integration, trying to integrate truth and lies, which is impossible. So it's all important to keep reinforcing that truth and lies can't both be true, and to see that, and voice of reason will point it out to you over and over and over again, and to always come back to that cornerstone as the foundation. Because then you don't journey too far away from it. Of course you'll go out on tangents. We all do. But we don't journey too far. Let me say, no, wait a minute. Let me go back to the basics here. So going back to the basics is all important. all important, and maybe some wonder, why do I keep stressing the same things over and over? Well, you have to keep touching base with the basics so you don't get too far lost in the logic of plausibility, because once you are working to integrate truth and lies, you rapidly become very lost, rapidly. And so it's super important to touch base with the basics every day. Very important. Which is why I say satsang every day is absolutely crucial for you. Don't go a day without it, because it literally only takes a day of working on integrating truth and lies for you to become very lost. It's like there's this deep, dark forest, and you're outside of it in a cleared field, and you decide to wander into that forest just for one day. Well, after one day of wandering into that forest, you look around, and all you see is this massive, deep, dark forest, and you forget how you got in there or the way out, and then you think, well, maybe the way out is this way, and then you end up wandering another day, and you've gone even deeper into the dark forest, and then you just... you feel lost. So the quote-unquote spiritual path, as it were, the spiritual path to realizing that you don't need to do anything except to see that you don't need to do anything, you have to do it every day if you want it to go smoothly. Now, of course, and even you can get lost in less than a day, but if you do spiritual inquiry, satsang, every day, and you do it the right way, where you touch base with the basics, that truth and lies can't both be true, and you will not stray too far away, and you will not get so severely lost, and therefore you won't get so severely depressed and in despair and in panic, and you won't get pulled into tangential paths that seem to be moving you towards enlightenment. But remember, logical plausibility defines enlightenment as integrating truth and lies. So you may think you're on a path to enlightenment, where in fact you're on a path of trying to integrate truth and lies. Everything has already been saved. You don't need to do anything. You don't need any path. You don't go anywhere. Don't need to go anywhere. Don't need to do anything. It's already been accomplished. And yet, if we think that truth and lies have to be integrated, we will insist that it hasn't yet been accomplished. We will say, well, how could it have already been accomplished? We haven't succeeded yet in this integrating process. The whole thing about a soul with energy bodies evolving through all this wonderful classroom that supposedly has been set up for this purpose, etc., that is simply the logic of plausibility and its dreaming and its imagining, setting you out on this path of trying to integrate truth and lies and claiming that it's all a learning process, that you eventually will learn how to do it. Eventually. And then the pot of gold at the end of this rainbow is eventually you'll have something better than both. Okay, that's the carrot that's held out. This is all nonsense. You never had to learn anything. You're not a soul, you're spirit. You never had to go on any journey whatsoever. It's a journey to nowhere. Everything has already been saved. Everything is already enlightened. Everything that needs to be accomplished has already been accomplished from the very beginning, prior to even taking one step. Simultaneously with this desire, this first step, simultaneously, there was no need to take the step at all. So it's very important to hear truth every day, because the delusion of the logical plausibility is, you know, it's immense. Because we look about and we say, oh my gosh, there's this vast, vast, endless domain, this universe, whatever you want to call it, all set up for us. How fortunate we are, all set up for our progress. Right? That's what we're told, that this has all been placed here, and we've been placed here simply to make progress. And we think, my gosh, how benevolent, how incredible this all is, how wonderful it all is, how fortunate we are, what an unlimited opportunity we have here to make progress. And yet it's all set up for us to try and make progress towards integrating truth and lies, to accomplishing the impossible. It's all a complete waste of time. There's no opportunity here at all. There's nothing to learn here at all. We can never learn to accomplish the impossible. We cannot learn that. Doesn't matter how many quote-unquote lessons we have. We can have infinite lessons, and this whole scenario of loss, existence, can seem to give us endless opportunities and lessons, but none of them will ever work. So they're really nothing at all. Lessons in futility is all they really are. And how many lessons in futility do we really need? Do we need any at all? I mean, can't we recognize the futile inherently without even needing any lesson at all? It should be completely, naturally apparent to us that we cannot change reality. And no amount of lessons will ever change that fact. So we don't need any lessons. So we don't need a vast laboratory, a vast classroom, as it were, to learn these lessons, as it were, to put ourselves through this lessening process that we think is benefiting us somehow. It's not benefiting us. Again, all of this is already enlightened. Everything's already enlightened. Don't need to do anything. Don't need to do a thing. And truth is inherently apparent to us. Reality knows truth inherently. It's always completely obvious. So we don't need any lessons. We weren't created stupid, so we have to learn all these lessons to figure out reality. No, all of reality knows all of reality. It's all totally, inherently known. Always has been the case. And so we spend our time on these thought songs, pulling our attention back to the basics. And the more we do that, the closer we get to realizing we don't need to do anything. No one, and here's another very important fact, no one has to do anything. No one. No one has ever had to do anything. And so that pulls you back from the lie that if you realize you don't have to do anything, that somehow that puts the burden or responsibility on someone else's shoulders and you're making it tougher for someone else. That is a lie. But it seems plausible, right? If the goal is to integrate truth and lies and you give that up and you say, no, I'm not going to work on that anymore, then it seems plausible that somebody else will have to do the work that you could have done but have now decided not to do. So it makes it harder for other people to eventually succeed. Okay, that's plausible, right? But it's false. It's not true. Because nobody has to do anything. No one ever has to do anything at all. Because enlightenment, everything is already enlightened. It's always been enlightened. So no one ever has had to do anything. So the fact that you see that does not change that fact, does not put an extra burden on anyone. Plausibility will say it does. Of course it will. But it's not true. Because the goal of plausibility can never be reached. So it's the goal that is the burden, not the realization that the goal can't be accomplished, that it does not put a burden. And yet this area feels full of guilt. You know, it feels like there's a cavity of guilt here, you know. Because plausibility will say, well, I'm going to have to slave drive everyone harder now that you have given up your role, your part in this. that I'm going to push everyone harder. Well, it may try to do this. But the fact that somebody has accepted that nothing needs to be done, that more than counterbalances the possibilities, threat to push everyone harder, and more than counterbalances that. Because the logic of plausibility has to, it cannot do it directly, has to jump through all these hoops, which just actually, it's hard to describe, but let's take it as true that the threat that, it's an empty threat. What it is saying is that eventually it will have to crack the whip harder, but that eventuality never comes, never arrives. So it's a threat. It's an empty threat, pushed into the future, which it seems impossible to counteract it, or because it says, well, eventually. How do you prove that eventually it will not? You see. So that is a tough one. But we can voice of reason, you know, is not worried by that at all. Doesn't see it as tough. From our standpoint, we're saying, wow, how can we be sure? How can we be sure? Just 1 minute here. Take a quick break. Okay, so how can we be sure of forever? It's like we're here now saying that it's not causing a situation to get worse. But if the logic of plausibility insists no, at some point eventually it will be trouble, then, you know, it seems like it's tough to assert that, you know, that at no point ever could that be possible, even though that is true. It is true that at no point will it ever become more difficult. Anyone who accepts that they don't need to do anything, that actually adds to the ease of it forever, makes it easier. And yet the plausibility can always challenge that. It can always challenge it. Plausibility can always challenge everything. Just because it challenges it doesn't make it true. All right, just because it challenges it doesn't make it true. But it will challenge. It will challenge that, and it'll challenge anything. It's challenging truth itself. So it's not that when we say that we're all already saved, that means that plausibility won't challenge that. That those who deny this won't challenge that. Of course they will, and they can say, "Oh, you're making it more difficult." In other words, they can say that too. It doesn't mean that it's true. It means they want it to be true, but it doesn't make it true. But herein. Is for me, I'm saying this is the final obstacle, really, that's in the way of this complaint. Like, plausibility will say, yeah, nothing needs to be done, everything's already been saved, but the fact that you've realized this or seeing it makes it more difficult for the rest of us to see it. Of course it's going to say that, because it doesn't want anyone to see it. So this is really the final, you know, guilt trip. And we're just looking at this now. So plausibility will say, sure, you can do it. Sure, this is all true, but it makes it more difficult for others to realize this. it's crazy. It just shows you what plausibility wants to be true, that it makes it more difficult. But of course, when anyone sees this, it is an enormous boost to everyone else to say, oh my gosh, it can be done. And of course, plausibility will say, no, this is totally wicked. Because yeah, it's there, but anyone who sees it makes it difficult for all the rest. But by following that logic, plausibility, then nobody can ever do it. Because whoever does it makes it more difficult for all the rest. So what the logic of plausibility says, okay, is that we all have to do it together. That's the only fair way, as it were. So the logic of plausibility says we must all wait until everybody's ready to do all at the same time, and that's the only way it can be done, which is just the ultimate delaying tactic, isn't it? Which means nobody does it now, which feeds into the logic of plausibility claiming that if nobody's done it, it must not be there. So what you really get in following this path is you get you go deeper and deeper into denial, all in the guise of trying to be fair, etc. So it's very clever, very tricky. Very tricky. And I'm sure you've heard it all before, that the song and dance of how we're all supposed to ascend together, be enlightened together, we're all supposed to realize together, it has to be done all as one, or can it be done at all this kind of stuff. It's already been done for all. We just need to accept the fact. To say we all have to do it together, you know, it's already been done. It's not a personal accomplishment. So the idea of us doing it together, that's ludicrous. It's already been done. We just have to accept that there is no one that has to do it. And there's no group that has to do it. Even including all of existence doesn't have to do it. It's not existence that does it. So to say that we all have to do it together is an absurdity. We're not doing it. It's choosing another idea, the idea of not trying to change reality that did it. It's not existence doesn't do it. So it's ludicrous. So really, by breaking ranks with this insanity, everybody realizes, oh, this can be done. And maybe temporarily. Temporarily, they will go into some sort of greater denial. That's possible. But it's temporary, and they'll rebound from that. And so in the big scheme of things, it absolutely helps shorten delay. Even if in the short term some might jump into greater denial, but just the very fact that they're in this greater denial is going to disturb the equilibrium of denial, as it were. And so it may seem that things are getting worse, but they're really getting better. Because the ineffectiveness of denial is being realized. And of course, plausibility's promise to all of us is that nobody will break ranks. So if someone breaks ranks, that shows that plausibility's a liar, right? It says it made a false promise. And so that shakes everyone up. We say, whoa. So maybe there is more fear initially, like, wait a minute. We've been lied to by plausibility. But then that automatically starts a openness to listening to another voice, as it were, the voice of reason. Opens the door just a crack. And people may, you know, deny that, say, no, it's not doing that. But it is. It is. So it may be that on the surface there's a denial and there's an insistence that anybody who realizes nothing needs to be done is somehow making things more difficult. But that's a false, it's a form of denial. It's actually making it easier. And this can be denied, but it doesn't change this fact. It doesn't change the fact. So it's like that. Because the whole structure of denial and delusion and impossibility gets shaken to its core when anyone realizes that it's already been accomplished. It's always been accomplished. And existence doesn't have to do anything. It's not existence that accomplishes it. that shakes the whole situation to its core. And then people realize, oh my gosh, you know, this system is not stable. It's not true. It doesn't work. All the promises are false. And that automatically the search for what is true, what is stable, takes place. Automatically takes place. Even though on the surface, there's a denial that it's taking place. It is taking place. And those who rally around denial, others may say, ah, I don't want to do that anymore. You know, I don't want to be more intense with this false path. And so it helps them that way too. Those who want to be super loyal to it, that super loyalty turns people off and says, no, I don't want to go that far. And so that helps also. So it's very, very beneficial. And those who go into super denial see that others are not going there, they're going to say, oh my gosh, maybe this super denial doesn't work either. So it throws the whole thing into doubt, the false path into doubt, which is a great thing. It's a great thing. It may seem to be a irritating thing, because of course we want everything to go smooth in this, on all these false paths. They don't go smooth anyway at all. And it's not good that they go smooth, because the smoother they go, the deeper you wander into that dark, dark forest, and later on you're going to regret it greatly. So it's actually beneficial that you get your, you know, shaken up by those who realize that everything is already saved. We don't have to do anything. No one has to do anything. No one has to do anything at all. That does shake things up, and that's a good thing. It makes your path bumpy. And so you eventually realize you don't need it. You don't need a path. Of course, as long as you think that you need a path, you're going to want a smooth path. But the truth is, you don't need any path at all. And if the path is bumpy and there's troubles on the path, that's a great thing. Because deep down, the truth is seeping in and you're starting to listen. Wait a minute, do I really need this path at all? I came to an impasse on my path. I reached an impasse. Can all paths are attempt to really integrate truth and lies as a means to developing something greater than both, transcends both, something new and different. And I came to an impasse, absolute impasse. I couldn't get past it. Total impasse. And I've been working on this impasse for so long. How do I clear out this impasse? How to get rid of these boulders? You know, how do I get rid of this wall that's in my path? I can't get rid of it. And gradually, you know, I'm coming now, you know, to this realization. I don't need any path. So whether the path is blocked or not doesn't mean anything, because I don't need to do anything. So why do I need a path? What do I need a path for? I don't need to learn anything. I don't need any lessons. I don't need to get anywhere. I don't need to accomplish anything. I'm not a soul evolving. Everything's already been saved. Everything's already been accomplished. For everyone. For all of existence. There's no aspect of existence that needs to do anything whatsoever. Nothing. So, who cares if the path is blocked? Let it be blocked. I don't need the path anyway. So that's the ultimate realization, is you don't need the path. But having your path seen to be blocked is very helpful. Otherwise, you just keep going down that path. Ananda Mayama says that suffering removes suffering. That God's grace uses suffering to free you from suffering. In other words, your path gets blocked to free you so you realize you don't need a path. So if you are feeling like your path is blocked, you're very fortunate, I'm telling you. You're really fortunate. Don't curse the great saviors that come into the world who simply witness to the fact that everything's already saved, always has always been saved, and nothing has to take place here. Don't curse them, because it may have seemed that they blocked your path somehow, that they caused denial to block your path or whatever. But that's the greatest blessing of all. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall be saved. In other words, blessed are those whose paths have been blocked, because they're the ones who will realize that they don't need a path. that they never needed any path. And those whose paths don't seem to be blocked, they keep going down those paths. And they look ahead and they see, oh my gosh, the path seems to extend forever. Isn't that great? Look at all the opportunity I have to learn and become better and become more free, more loving, more whatever. And so they keep going down that path, wasting their time. It's the one whose path is blocked that is the fortunate ones. Because then they say, well, I can't go anywhere. Then they start gradually, the realization says, wait a minute. You know, the voice of reason explains to them that they don't need to do anything. They don't need to go. Everything's already been saved. And all they have to do is see that. And they're in bliss, in endless delight, stable delight, stable bliss. So blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those whose paths have been blocked. And I know that a lot of you who are watching these videos are watching them because your path has been blocked. And you're feeling terrible. You're feeling you can't move. You're feeling blocked. You can't go anywhere. My gosh. My path was so blocked. It's unbelievable. It was blocked in every direction. I could go nowhere. Everywhere I looked, I was blocked. I was blocked. No matter what I tried, I was blocked. It's horrible. It seemed horrible at the time. Because I said, well, I can't keep up with everybody. I can't keep up this learning process. I can't keep up with the Joneses. I can't keep up with all these spiritual paths that everybody's going on, you know, that all these paths to enlightenment everybody's on. I can't keep up. I can't do it. And yet it's turned out that this was the greatest blessing. Because in not being able to do any of that, I gradually have got to this point of clarifying that nobody needs to do anything. And this is the real truth. This is the truth. And so this is, you know, this is salvation from the nightmare. So, at least in a little bit, I know it's not easy, let it seep in to you that this being feeling blocked, that you're blocked, etc., is actually the greatest blessing. Because your path is the realization that you don't need any path. And that nobody needs any path, and that no one has ever needed any path. It's that realization, and this blockage of your path is there to help you with this. So don't fight against it. You don't have to like it. In fact, you won't like it. You don't have to want it. But you can realize that this is what you really want, and this is what you really love, is that this path is blocked, and it gives you the opportunity to realize you don't need any path at all. You've never needed any path. It gives you that opportunity, so you should make the most of it. Make the most of it. And I wish I could come across teachers that teach this, really. It's difficult in this world. The only frustration is it's so hard to find this kind of teaching. So difficult. I found it in A Course in Miracles. And again, as you play the piano, so you hear the tune. So I guess this is what I have gotten out of it. Now, others have studied A Course in Miracles and got something completely opposite out of it. They got this idea that there's some big path that they're on, and this is wonderful. So just the opposite. But I truly have gotten out of that this clarification. What I got out of it was listen to the voice of reason. That's what I got out of it. And by listening to the voice of reason within me, I've gotten to this point of seeing this now. I don't really need to study the words in A Course in Miracles, because I'm convinced that this voice of reason is within us and it speaks truly. And I can therefore listen to it. So even if I, you know, don't have the book, I mean, I've gone 15, 16 years without studying at all. Recently, I just bought I didn't even have it. I bought a new book, and I've just kind of been going back over it, seeing, you know, in hindsight. Yeah, I say, yeah, it's all there. But The main thing that is there is trusting in the voice of reason. That is what it's really there for. To trust in it, to stay with it. It's just reinforcing that. And once you really trust the voice of reason, you can stick with it, and it will bring you to this point here. I haven't seen yet. I'm not seeing that of this perfect overlay yet. But I'm clear about that. Yeah, this is the right thing to do. And again, it's only guilt that holds anyone back, really. Fear, guilt. You can abolish the fear, but the guilt is the toughest one. That somehow you're going to make it more difficult for others, etc. That's you know, the toughest one. Because it's you can't explain that to others. They're going to think that way, you see. Because they're still listening to logical plausibility, and they'll say, it's plausible that you're making it more difficult. What can you do? It's not true, though. You're making it way easier to use less delay. You're shortening the delay for everyone. Greatly, 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 greatly. But plausibility will never admit to that. Never. So, it may seem that in realizing, seeing this overlay, perfect presence, that everything's already enlightened, that others will think that you're not doing a good thing, you're not helpful for them. And so I guess there's that kind of worry that others will reject this and saying it's not helpful. In fact, it's the opposite. It's very hurtful, very harmful. And how do you deal with that? Maybe you're afraid that the overlay will somehow adjust and change so as to not to make people feel that way. But no, it won't do that. I have to see that. It won't do that. So I'm just, there is this point here of this guilt thing. You know, should you do it or not? Are you gonna, is the enlightenment going to suddenly recede from some here because it seems like it's making it more difficult for them, etc., etc.? That is the question. You know, that is the question that I cannot know for sure the answer until I do it. I can see that it's only a plausible deception. It's a plausible deception that'll happen. It won't happen. But I don't know for certain that it. There is that little step of uncertainty. Can't be totally certain. Yeah. Okay, very great. I'm just trying to ferret out the difficulty that people have on the path here that we have on getting free of the belief we need a path. And it is this, there is a slight uncertainty. And how does it get resolved? I don't know, you know, it's the first thing to do when you run into something like this where you have an uncertainty and you think, uh-oh, I can't go any further because this is kind of uncertain. The first thing to do is simply acknowledge it, that this is so. And that it cannot be changed. You can't change existence. You can't change plausibility. It comes from plausibility. You can't change it. You can't fight against it. Just agree with it. Yeah, there is this plausible scenario. Okay. So don't struggle with it either. Okay, I'm sort of showing you here live how to deal with these supreme difficulties that you run into. Don't struggle with it. Have a certain confidence that you know there's a resolution to this. Even though you may not quite see it, there is definitely resolution. You're sure that there is. So you don't struggle with it. You don't attack it. You just smile and say, okay, there is this plausible trouble. I'm already starting to see, you know, partial resolution to this. You just sort of look at it with that right attitude. No attack, no retreat or attack, no struggle, confidence, trusting in the voice of reason, looking at it, okay, not trying to change the plausibility, not trying to argue with it. Say, yeah, you can always, you can say the plausibility, yes, that argument can always be made. But the overlay is already aware of that and has already overlaid it entirely. So plausibility will make this assertion that you're making it more difficult. And yet the overlay blesses that too. That's too is already saved. Everything is already saved. And so what happens is people will see that. They'll see plausibility saying, oh, the overlay has to recede here. It's plausible that it must recede here. And yet it doesn't recede. So people will see that and say, wait a minute. A plausibility said it should recede and it's not. What's going on here? Something isn't right. And I told you about Ananda Maima that in looking at her, her bliss never receded in any circumstance. And you keep thinking that it's plausible, it must recede here. It must recede. To be fair, it doesn't recede. And then that says, wow, something here, plausibility doesn't understand this. And that lessens your faith in plausibility. Okay, it lessens it. Because you're sure that it must recede, to be fair, and it doesn't. So even though you say, well, it's not fair, you're still saying, wait a minute, plausibility doesn't understand this, though. There's something that plausibility doesn't understand. That, again, begins to lessen your faith and trust and belief in the logical plausibility. And you say, well, it's not a bad thing that it didn't recede. Because I like the fact the bliss is still there. So it's not a terrible thing. Plausibility told me it'd be a terrible thing, and it's not. So again, you say, plausibility has been lessened. You know, you think, oh, they were going to get angry and attack me because I don't believe in them. And they don't. And I told them that they're making it more difficult. They should get angry at that. And they don't. And nothing happens the way I thought it would happen. And you say, and it's not so bad because, wow, they're still completely blissful. And that's great. I like that. So the whole belief system of plausibility begins to be thrown into doubt. And you think, well, that's a bad thing. And yet the bliss is still there. And you say, no. Huh, wow, what's going on here? So it raises the whole belief system of plausibility into the light and holds it there. And you start being able to see it in a different light. That's what really happens. Because I've seen it, and I have an example of this. Raman Maharshi, same thing. We have examples of what really happens. And it's not what we plausibly believe must happen. It's not. And it's not a bad thing that it's different. Again, because we think that maintaining the authority of the logic of plausibility is all important. And yet when the authority of plausibility falls on its face, we think that's a disaster, and yet it isn't. Because we see this bliss and we say, wait a minute, this bliss is not thinking that the logic of plausibility falling on his face is a terrible thing. They're not bothered by it at all. We say, whoa, holy cow, wait a minute, you know, that's amazing. That's amazing. Yeah. So we're getting into the very heart of the whole situation here, which is what is necessary. Because the logic of plausibility says that when the authority of the logic of plausibility is greatly undermined, that this must bring about a disastrous feeling for everyone. It's inescapable. A loss for everyone, as it were. And yet here's this being who is not giving any evidence of that whatsoever, that there's some drastic loss. And so you have to say, wow, the logic of plausibility, there's an exception to it, or what's going on? And something within you is kind of like cheering, saying, yeah, I like it. Didn't expect to like it. You can't help but like it. There's something within you that likes this fact that something has stood up to the logic of plausibility and it's not causing them any trouble. And there's something within you that really likes that attracted to that, saying, oh, wow, that's great. How do they do that? And what's going on here? Sure, it seems like it's going to be a lot of work to figure this out, and yet there's an attraction to it. But it's a lot less work than continuing with delay. Because as long as you continue with delay, you know, you're continuing to be on this path of trying to integrate truth and lies, then you will continue to suffer. You know, for a while. Sometimes you think the path is all full of light and love and creativity and stuff, but then the path makes a turn and you find yourself going through the grinder. Absolutely being every last bit of joy and happiness and et cetera, is being ground out of you, pressed out of you. Brutal. You're just completely brutalized. So every last ounce of hope that you had gets dashed. Desires, beliefs, everything just gets absolutely crushed. And then after that, you find the path goes back into sort of a lighted path again, and you start building up hope and build everything up again. And you go and you build all this hope and desire and belief and et cetera, and everything's, you think, oh, I'm really going towards enlightenment. And then again, you go around a turn and you go into this scenario where you lose it all. And that just simply takes place over and over and over and over again. So really, the path of plausibility is unbelievably brutal. And brutality cannot have its day unless it builds up naivete and light and love and beauty and all this path that seems so wonderful. And you think you're really on the path to integrating truth and lies. And you have all this hope. And then brutality comes in and dispossesses you of all of that. And it seems as though, you know, it's you've been brutalized. You've lost it all. And so that's what happens. That is what happens. So it's super important to get on the right path, get on the path of realizing you don't need a path. And these great teachers are instrumental, okay, in the witnesses to this fact are instrumental. You don't even have to call them teachers. They're not really teachers. They're those who've realized they don't need to do anything. Nothing needs to be accomplished in existence. Nothing needs to be done at all. They just hear as witnesses to this fact, as witnesses. They're just witnesses to truth, to the fact that nothing needs to be done in existence. They're instrumental. They're super helpful. Because you get this disconnect, like, whoa, this shouldn't have happened. How can this possibly be happening? They can't possibly be blissful all the time. It's not possible. And you get this, like, whoa. And you end up feeling like, my gosh, I can't really, my path seems blocked. I can't seem to go along like I used to, which is great. Because you end up not building up naivete of this love and light and we're going towards all, we're all going to ascend together and everything's be blissful, all this kind of stuff. You don't go down that path. Your path seems to be blocked because you say, wait a minute, I can't figure out a path anymore because I can't integrate this one who's in bliss all the time. I can't integrate it. I can't seem to integrate it. What's going on? That's super helpful. Super, super helpful. Guaranteed, I could not be where I am today without Ananda Mahima, without Ramana Maharshi, without A Course in Miracles, which is by Jesus Christ. I guaranteed I would not be here. No way, no how. And without a voice of reason, the voice of reason within me. All of that. Of course, all of that would have been ineffective without a voice of reason. The voice of reason, if it wasn't there, all the witnessing in the world wouldn't be helpful. Wouldn't be helpful. But all of this witnessing simply reinforces that, hey, you've got a voice of reason within you, and this voice of reason will lead you to this place of realizing you don't need to do anything, nothing needs to be done. nothing needs to be done. It's already been accomplished. So that is the combination that works. So seek for a great teacher. Okay? A great teacher. Don't be satisfied with less than that. Seek for a great teacher. A witness that nothing needs to be done. Nothing has never needed to be done whatsoever in existence. Nothing needs to be accomplished. Seek for that teacher who is in constant bliss. Uninterrupted bliss. Seek for that teacher. That's the one that will truly enable you to turn towards the reason, the voice of reason within you. That's within you. It's within all of us. That will lead you to realize the realization that everything's already been accomplished in existence, and there's nothing in existence that needs to accomplish anything. Not even the tiniest little tiny sliver of existence, the tiniest little subparticle, God particle, whatever you want to call it. No insects, no plants, no animals, no nature, no people, no nothing, no subtle beings. Nothing in existence needs to accomplish anything at all. They can give up existence right now. Doesn't make the slightest difference to existence. Nothing needs to be accomplished. Loyalty to existence doesn't need to be accomplished at all. Everything, whatever needed to be accomplished, which is simply the overlay of existence, was accomplished from the very beginning. And it remains with existence forever. Until all aspects of spirit have realized that nothing needs to be accomplished. And then existence will simply dissolve into the nothingness that it is. The mirage will simply no longer appear. And then this overlay, this blessing, will remain with creation as a blessing. It won't disappear. It remains. Because it comes from the idea of not trying to change reality. That blessing will always be there. As a reminder to don't that choosing the idea of trying to change reality has this counterpart there, and we'll say, there's no need to choose that idea of trying to change reality. We won't do it again. Not that we're not free to do it. We are free to do it, but we will see very clearly the blessing, and the whole thing will be apparent to us, and we'll say, this is how it ends. You see? And so it ends at its beginning. And so, you know, we won't choose that idea. We'll see exactly the totality of this idea is really just simply the ending of it, which is this blessing, which is already present. So in other words, this idea will already be present in its resolved form. And so as a blessing. So it's amazing how this is, our freedom is intact, and yet we do not choose this idea again, because it's again the how it is experienced is already present with us as the overlay. So very good news here, very, very great news. Find the one who's always in bliss, because that one is witnessing truly. Because those who are not always in bliss are believing that the overlay is making adjustments based on trying to expedite the whole thing, and that some aspects of that it's trying to keep the authority of plausibility, trying to adjust to that, and so they will not be in bliss all the time. Maybe sometimes they can seem to be. But the one who's always in bliss, steady bliss, knows the truth, is seeing the truth. Those who don't do that are assuming plausibly how truth is, but are mistaken about that. So they're engaged with the logic of plausibility. They're still engaged with it. If the bliss isn't steady, they're still engaged with it, thinking that they know that the, you know, how the overlay is working. The overlay doesn't work. It's not working. It's not changing. It's from the very beginning. It was done. It's finished. And it remains. It accomplished. Instantly, it accomplished its purpose and remains that way. So it's already done. It's not adjusting. It's not changing. It's not adapting. Not at all. And so the one who is seeing this overlay, the presence of unconditional love, knows this fact. And so that is reflected as bliss. It's reflected as bliss. And they don't look at plausibility. Plausibility will say, wait, look away from that and look at what, how it must be in the future. That, there's the problem, right? There is the problem. Plausibility will say, sure, it's that way right now, but it must be different in the future. And plausibility will just then present its case and keep presenting it. Keep spinning it. It's the ultimate spin doctor. If you ever wonder why the universe is always spinning, it's because the logic of plausibility is the ultimate spin doctor. Everything's always spinning. So it will say, yeah, you need to look at how it's going to be, not how it is now. And therein lies the challenge, to be able to dismiss this. And we literally can be perfect witnesses here. We have uninterrupted bliss here, as long as we don't buy into the logic of plausibility spin about, yeah, it's fine now, but it won't be that way in the future. It can't possibly be that way in the future. There is no future for the overlay. It's right now. It's already accomplished it. It's done. So it doesn't need any future. and that, you know, seeing that, you know, staying with that. Some call it staying in the now, as it were, but it's a little more profound than that. But that is a way of talking about it. I would assume that. I approach it from a different angle than the non-dualists. They talk about, like, what's wrong with right now, or stay in the now. But it's really that it's already done. It's finished. Perfectly finished. So there is no future to a perfect finish. It's like the finish line has been crossed. So what do you, you know, what are we talking about? We say, well, yeah, but in further on down the race, you know, there's going to be problems. No. All problems have been permanently resolved. The problem of existence has been permanently resolved simply by choosing a new idea. The idea of not trying to change reality. Within existence itself, none of the problems are ever solved. None of them. But by choosing the idea of not trying to change reality, that idea doesn't have any problems. So, by exercising your freedom, that does permanently solve the problem of not exercising your freedom. The problem is we're not exercising our freedom. We think we've lost it. And how do you cure that? By exercising it. It's the only way. You don't cure it by talking about it and not exercising it, because then the plausibility will say, well, you know, you're not exercising it, so maybe you don't have it. Okay, well, I could go on and on. But Maybe it's enough for now. This is just inquiry. This is how I've spent my life. By looking at this and boiling it down to its very essential components and seeing what must take place. Again, it's important to maintain your confidence. When you come across one who's here with uninterrupted bliss, who simply reminds us that nothing needs to be done, you get confidence that it can be done, that realizing that nothing needs to be done, that choosing this, that it is possible. So you get this sort of inner confidence that you're going to succeed eventually, that you know it can be done here. That realizing that nothing needs to be done, that can be done. And so you carry that confidence with you in inquiry. So you don't panic. You don't get all fearful. Like, you know how when you lose confidence, you think you need to appease someone and cling. You know, you start clutching at straws, and then plausibility will just destroy you, you know, just lead you, spin you away, far away. But if you're confident, you remain quiet and still, and you just wait for the clarification to come. You know it's there. You know it is there. You just have to let it come into focus. And then you don't engage with the logical plausibility so much. You don't engage with it because you know, it's like you're saying, well, I know this is logical plausibility. I know it's false. It's all just spin. So I'm not really worried about arguing. There's nothing to argue about. I know it's false, so why argue with it? I just need to see what is true. So don't, Jesus said, agree with your adversary. Don't argue with the logical plausibility. You know it's false, so what is there to argue about? Nothing. So you don't get, you know, agitated. You just stay quiet and you work on seeing, you know, the truth, seeing clearly. But also don't pick a fight with plausibility either. You know, don't pick a fight. Don't go out of your way. Just keep going towards the realization that you don't need any realization. No one needs any realization. Existence doesn't need any realization whatsoever. Because you have the freedom to choose a new idea, you see? If we believe we don't no longer have that freedom, therefore we think existence itself needs realization. It does not. There's nothing in existence that needs any realization. We simply need to choose a new idea. The idea of not trying to change reality. And that idea, its effect, is perfect stability. Perfect. Bliss. And so, nothing needs realization. We don't need it. No, none of us need it. No part of existence will ever need realization because we are free to choose a new idea. We haven't lost our freedom. If we believe we've lost our freedom to choose a new idea, we will then be working on realization here. So all this work on realization in the world is based on the belief we've lost our freedom. And existence cannot come up with any realization. What is it? What if we believe we've lost our freedom? What good is realization of any kind? It's futile, waste of time. We haven't lost our freedom. And the only way we can realize that is to choose a new idea. Because existence itself is the premise is that we can change reality, which means we have to lose our freedom. It's very simple. So this is coming back to the beginning of this video now. We're looping all the way back. Again, no one needs any realization. There is no realization. You need to choose a new idea. That's different than realization. It's different than enlightenment. I say everything's already enlightened. To take it a step further, nothing needs to be enlightened. Existence doesn't need to be enlightened. We simply need to choose a new idea. And that is, then we realize, reality has not been changed. We haven't lost our freedom. And everything is then perfect. If we know that reality hasn't been changed, what else do we need to know? That is the realization that we need. But we won't get that until we exercise our freedom. And we exercise our freedom by realizing we don't need, existence doesn't need realization. We're free to choose a new idea. We don't need to do anything about existence. We don't need to bring existence up into a realized condition. We don't need to do that. It's just a belief. You can't bring a belief into a realized condition. Belief cannot know that reality. The belief that reality can be changed cannot know that reality cannot be changed. It cannot know it. So it's futile. You cannot realize it. It can only be a belief. Belief is not knowing. Is not directly experiencing it. Faith and belief and trust, all of that cannot know it. And therefore, it cannot. No realization is possible. So another way of putting it is there's no realization that is possible in existence. None. There is no knowing that can take place. There is no direct experiencing. Because it's the belief, the idea that is possible to change reality. And since that's impossible, you can never, but that idea that it's possible to change reality cannot know that it's impossible, because it was never any experiencing in the first place. It's like saying non-experience. Non-experience cannot know that it is non-experience. Cannot. Only reality can know reality. The denial of reality cannot know reality. That's not possible. Because the denial of reality is what it is. You can't change it. So, really, the path to realization is really giving up the belief in realization. Reality doesn't need to realize itself, as it were. It inherently knows itself. By exercising our freedom, we will inherently know our freedom. And in this case, we exercise it by choosing the idea of not trying to change reality, which then does give us this overlay effect, this presence of unconditional love that seems to overlay the dream, which gives us continuity. And we rest in that for a while. Okay. And again, we've already chosen it. We just have to accept that fact. Our spirit's already chosen this idea. But you see, spirit can hold multiple ideas at once. So spirit's holding both these ideas, both the idea of changing reality and the idea of not changing reality. Spirit's holding both of those ideas. All the spirit has to do is to realize that by setting down the idea of trying to change reality, it's not going to experience a loss in continuity, because the idea of not trying to change reality already assumes and holds within it that the idea of trying to change reality was chosen. Okay, so it honors that. It doesn't try to change it, doesn't accept it. So we won't have that loss in continuity. Okay, so let's at least take a look at this, that spirit can hold unlimited ideas at the same time. It's we call it, well, multidimensional. It's not even beyond that. The idea of multidimensionality gives us at least some vague concept of it, that spirits experiencing is infinitely rich. It can experience one idea at a time or many simultaneously and weave those together and have this rich tapestry, as it were, each idea remaining with its effects, but weaving that together as this incredible richness. We don't know what that's like because we've been believing that we're only experiencing just one. So spirit, simultaneously with choosing the idea of changing reality, it chose the idea of not changing it. But the idea of not changing it would not have been chosen unless we had the idea of trying to change it. So the idea of not trying to change reality allows the fact that we chose the idea of trying to change reality. It doesn't, it's not against it. It's not trying to deny that. No, it accepts that fact. And so it can also accept all the format that we were using, and just overlays it, provides just an overlay of all of that. But we do have to set down the one idea of changing reality. We have to set that idea down, because as long as we have that idea, we won't be aware of the other idea. We'll be in denial of it. We'll deny it's possible because we're denying our freedom. We say this is the only idea there is. We have to believe that. We have to believe that. Otherwise, we would know that reality is not so, that we can choose another idea, and then the whole thing would be ridiculous. So the idea of changing reality has to insist that we don't have the freedom to choose another idea. It has to insist upon it. So we do have to exchange this idea for the other one. But spirit has had both of them from the very beginning. And then we reach a point now when we just decide, oh, one is all we need. We only need the one of not trying to change reality, because that gives us continuity and also enables us to know reality cannot be changed. We know it. To know our freedom. It gives us that. So we've gone on an excursion here this morning of looking into many facets of our reluctance and our resistance and our feeling of hopelessness and lack of freedom, et cetera, et cetera. And seeing through all of that and seeing what the remedy is, realizing that even though when we become uncertain of all of this, we still remember, no, but it is true, because we've been clear about it. You know, we spent this time clarifying it, and we know that it is true. And so we have confidence we can get back to it. We know we can get back to it. Again, seek out the teachers who have uninterrupted bliss. And that will maintain your confidence, and you will have confidence, which is very important. Okay, enough's enough. Let us stop this recording now. And it's been an excellent one. Time very well spent. Very great. That's it.